Hey, good morning, everybody. I am going to start our live stream in just a moment. Meanwhile, as I copy the link onto our Canvas page, I do want to play a little song for you. It's my favorite chemistry song. I know you're like, this isn't a chemistry class, but it doesn't matter, right? Because you're just going to listen to this while I do my work. It's called Meet the Elements. Full of paints that are mixed to make. Okay. Yeah, that's a funny way to begin the class, but that's the way I want to begin the class. So let's take a look at what's going on in our lives. By the way, I hope you're all staying safe. You don't have to stay inside all the time, but remember, we're trying to do the social distancing because we believe it will make a difference. Oh, I'm supposed to just click over here. Let's see. Let's go ahead and jump to your page and take a look from the student view. I want to remind you, you have crash course videos to do. Of course, you know that. Crash course videos. Let's see. Today, just one, white dwarfs and planetary nebula. That's a little ahead of where we are, but that's great. It's better to be a little bit ahead than a little bit behind. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. So great to see you guys. Thanks for coming. So anyways, let's see. The most missed questions, remember, are due. And yes, those of you who have not yet watched it, you want to watch the stream from Monday. Sorry, Tuesday. Our class is on Tuesday, Thursday. And then do the little quiz that goes with it so that you can get participation points. So that's still open. And then we have, the rest of it is going to be do after the break. I do want to point out to you that we have tutors available. So, how do you get to the tutoring information? It's a new thing right now. So let's see. We go to Pages. And if you click here, Tutoring and PAL Schedule, there's a new schedule. Okay, please look at this schedule. And if you click on it, you will find this list. So I have not tried it from here, but actually today is Thursday. At 8:30, Liz is supposed to be there. I wonder if this would work right now. Let's just try. Okay, you have to log in with your thing. I don't know if that worked. Hold on, let me go back again. Let's try it again. Now let's try it one more time. And meet. Oh, camera is starting. Sure. Allow. Okay. Hey, how you doing, Liz? This is a cool thing that we can do. Anyways, you guys can meet up with Liz. This is Sean. I'm here to. Oh, I'm not even in the group. I have to ask her. So nobody's there right now. But at 8:30, she'll be available. What? Okay. Uh-oh. I don't know what I just did. Ignore that. Okay. Just ignore that. Okay. So that's our new way of getting to the tutors. Please use that. PAL will still be through Zoom, and I will let you know about that. But anyways, in the meantime, that's how you can get tutoring help. And you still get extra credit if you go to the tutors. So ask your questions, get extra credit. Coming up after the break, we do have stuff that's due. And again, you don't have to wait for me to tell you. April 21st is a long time. Oh, Griffith Observatory is not going to happen. They are closed. Okay, so, you know, it's kind of a bummer that all this stuff is happening. I just want you to be aware that you have a chance right now to be resilient. And resilience is something, good morning, is something that we all need. And compassion, empathy, because you're going through this as well. Can I just encourage everyone? There's a reason why we're doing this, right? We would rather see a little bit of disruption and actually major disruption. It's a major disruption, right? Economic loss. We're really hurting, right? Except what if people were dying? You know, and I think that would be even worse, right? And I think we would all agree that that's the situation. So I just want you to be aware, even though you're young, that that you are still susceptible. And I, you know, again, it's very interesting. They're discovering more and more about this coronavirus. Apparently, 30% of the people that are getting the coronavirus are asymptomatic. They don't know they're infected. They're just, you know, they're feeling normal, which is kind of cool. But actually not, right? It means that you could infect other people. So just be aware of that. And then the other thing is, I know that the youngest population have not been hit hard, but it turns out that teenagers and above in their, you know, 20s to 30s, people that normally would not be affected are definitely malaffected. And it's sudden, right? So it can be very sudden. And it's just your fluid-filled lungs, you can't breathe. That's physics. So please just be careful. It would be better for you to, have I been working out? Well, I don't know how much working out, but I took a walk on the beach yesterday. It was beautiful. And I would encourage you guys, we live in an incredibly beautiful place. It's something that's good for your soul to stop and take a walk. If you can get up early before dawn, by the way, it's been clear. I know I didn't do it this morning, but I have this plan over the break to get up and look at Jupiter and Saturn and Mars. I hope there's some way that we can return to meeting again, and then I can show you guys live. If not, maybe this summer the star parties will be on and you will have a chance to go to a star party. Anyways, we'll find a way. There is a way. Where there's a will, there's a way. So stay positive, and it's better to be positive than mope around, okay? Find something positive to do. And you could work on this course or read a book or do something that you've been meaning to do and just put off for a long time. Now is the time, okay? So anyways, here we go. We're going to start talking about the sun again. We're going to finish up chapter 10. I was pretty much done. And then we'll jump right into chapter 11. It's really cool material. I'm going to teach you some fun things today, and I'm so happy that you're all here to join me. We're going to go ahead and make the most of it. Okay, yes, and there's a chat window if you have questions. and you want to ask a question, go ahead and ask it. Okay, I'll be looking at it from time to time. Also, if something happens to my audio, I'm keep checking it. I'm getting better at checking it. Please let me know as soon as you can, and then I will swap the batteries. I think we're okay for an hour and 20 minutes. Okay, let's jump into our slides. All right, so we're on chapter 10. We're just going to review just a little bit. We talked about the coronal mass ejection, and I told you a little story about the 1860s, how the telegraph batteries were actually blowing up because they were being charged by the electrical energy that was being generated by the coronal mass ejection. I want to tell you one other thing. It turns out that we have a pair of satellites called the Solar Dynamic Observatory, and they are watching the sun all the time. It's actually, you know, really cool. And you know what? I shouldn't do this, but you know what? Let me just do it anyways. Let me just actually, now that I think about it, let me show you this because it's so amazing. This is NASA. We love NASA, right? Solar SDO. Let's put SDO, NASA. This is the Solar Dynamic Observatory, and it's a live view of the sun in so many different ways. And we have, look at these pictures of the sun. These are live pictures of the sun, and they're different colors. What is the different colors? And of course, the answer is different frequencies of light. We're studying the sun in all of these different ways and looking for patterns and looking for indications, for example, of a coronal mass ejection. One of the exciting things that we've discovered in recent years, like there's something interesting going on up here. Do you see it? There's an interesting feature there. And I kind of see something happening there. Maybe a sunspot. By the way, maybe we should just, I don't see an actual sunspot though. No sunspots. Doppler, oh, this is so cool. So again, spaceweather.com, we can see, nope, no sunspots, 9 days in a row. But who knows, you know, they may show up one of these days. All right, so we have live spacecraft telescopes watching all the time. And the idea is we want some warning if a coronal mass ejection event is occurring. And one of the ways that we want that warning is there's a little time between the coronal mass ejection and the time that would hit the Earth. And so what we can do is we can actually tell satellites that are vulnerable to turn away from the sun and close up their solar panels to protect their interior electronics. And so it hasn't been direct in 100 years, but if it were to be a direct strike, that would be something that we would think about doing. Even if it's not quite direct, we can also, we can get a tangential hit. Okay, I'm looking. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Okay. Okay, so you have a channel, Fabulous Cat. Okay, well, what do you do on your channel? Anyway, so one of the benefits of the coronal mass ejection is if we even get a partial hit, right, just a tangential hit, it turns out we get more activity and therefore we get a better aurora display. So the auroras can change in intensity by the amount of solar wind. And the more solar wind, the more coronal mass ejection material comes out of the sun. The better those auroras will be. Okay, so I forgot to tell you something. A coronal mass ejection is usually prefaced by a coronal hole. So we can actually, if we can see the corona, we can see the formation of an area where a coronal mass ejection will occur. If it happens to be right in the middle of the sun, it's going to come towards the Earth. And so those are the ones we watch out for. But there have been none, right, in so many years. So solar winds, interesting thing, right? The sun flings off more than 1 million tons of matter every second. Wow, that's crazy. And over the life of the sun, that's still pretty small. And how fast are they going? Between 200 and 500 kilometers per second. So quite rapid. Remember, these are kinetic energy particles. What protects us from these? The magnetic field of the Earth, right? Now, imagine that another star is flinging these out. And they're actually flinging them out at our solar system. Do we have any protection? And thank you for asking. The answer is yes. We have another magnetic field. The magnetic field around the sun is the most important magnetic field in our solar system. And it actually is protecting us from cosmic rays. Now, cosmic rays are particles, right? Even though we say rays, they're little high-energy particles coming from other stars or other things. that could be from black holes, quasars, blazars. We'll talk about those later. So there are many sources of them. But if they come shooting towards the solar system, the magnetic field of the sun deflects most of them, right? Only a few of them can get through. And so that's a really cool thing. So we have the heliosphere is the region where the magnetic field of the sun is important. We have our inner solar system, and then the heliopause is the boundary between the magnetic field. This is the region around our, this is the little bubble around our solar system. And now we're in interstellar space, right? So the heliopause is that boundary. And you might say, well, that's pretty far away, isn't it? And the answer is yes, very far away. Have human beings ever been there? No. Have spacecraft ever been there? And the exciting thing to tell you is, yes, two spacecraft have crossed this boundary. And so we know quite a bit more now because of that. They are the Voyager 1 and Voyager 2. And if you're interested, you should go read about that. It's really a cool story. In fact, some of you have asked, is there any way we can get extra credit? And one of my favorite movies in recent years was a video that they put out about the Voyager missions. And so we may do that. Would anybody like extra credit by watching the Voyager movies? Anybody interested? If anybody's interested, I might be able to set that up for you. Okay, so that would be an opportunity. I know there's all the good extra credit seems to be gone, except the tutors are still available. Okay, so don't forget that. Okay, so CMEs only eject a minor amount of mass and energy into the solar system. Is that true or false? And I'm going to just pause. You know, those of you who are watching the recorded version later, what you want to do is pause it and see if you can figure out the answer. Of course, yes, extra credit. Okay, good. So the answer is, what do you think? So you paused, and you're not going to get the answer right away. But of course, the answer is false, right? These are incredibly powerful ejections. Okay, next one. The sunspot's darkest region, we're talking about one individual sunspot, is called the, let's see if you can figure that out. Anybody figured out yet what that is? And that would be called the umbra. The umbra is the dark center. The region just around the umbra is called the penumbra. Okay, penumbra. Flares are caused by very twisted magnetic field lines that break and then reconnect outside of the sun and then travel away from the sun. Would you consider that to be true or false? And the answer is true, right? That is true. And last one, the sunspot cycle, not the last one, I have two more. The sunspot cycle, which means more sunspots, less sunspots, more sunspots again. How many years between that? And the answer is 11 years. But how about the magnetic cycle of the sun? What is the magnetic cycle of the sun? And if you want to think about that for a moment, what do we mean? The sun is magnetic. It has a certain state. How long does it take to return to the original state? And the original state actually takes, you can think about that, 22 years, right? So what happens every 11 years at the peak of sunspot activity is the sun's polarity flips. So it begins, let's say, north on the top, south on the bottom, north magnetic pole on the top, south magnetic pole on the bottom. After 11 years, it flips, and after another 11 years, flips back again. So it takes 22 years before a full cycle has occurred. Okay, that's chapter 10. Woo! Okay, and on to chapter 11. I gotta say, nobody's asking questions, but, you know, I'm sure you will ask the tutors, right? Okay, so here is a fun chapter I'm going to enjoy. I hope we can get through a bunch of this because there's some really neat stuff. Chapter 11 is how do we measure stars, right? What do we measure? Now, I would tell you, actually, a couple of years ago, before when I first started teaching here, there is only one way to measure stars. And the way that we measure stars is from the starlight, right? The light that comes to us from the stars. Ooh, I'm all lit up. Okay, I can't decide. What should I do? Stand here or there? Okay. You cover everything so clearly. Oh, no questions. Okay, well, that's great. But if you have questions, please don't be afraid. I'm getting your questions over here, and I will answer them as soon as I can. And actually, I will start having office hours. If you want to have an office hour with me anytime soon, send me an email, and we'll set up a Zoom conference. Otherwise, I will be trying to do a regular office hour. Okay, I may even try today to do that, which means you can come and hang out and ask questions or just chat, whatever you want to do. Okay, and I'll probably do that with Zoom because they did give me a pro account. I can have unlimited, not unlimited, I have 100 people or whatever. So anyways, so chapter 11. So a couple years ago, I said the only way to see the stars would be to see the stars, the light of the stars, in any different frequency, right? It could be visible, it could be infrared, it could be ultraviolet, x-ray, you know, gamma rays. But up until a few years ago, means in 2015, we have a new way to see the universe. And this is a neat, neat thing. It's really exciting. You're not here to understand, but I am super, I'm like shaking with excitement. It's so cool to see this. One of the videos you have to watch in the future will help you understand what's so exciting. But the new area of astronomy, brand new field for measuring the universe, is gravitational waves. And so LIGO, L-I-G-O, you will need to know that name a little bit later. The Laser Interferometry Gravitational Observatory is actually detecting gravitational waves, and it allows us to not see directly, but to perceive very dramatic events out in the universe. And it's pretty neat, okay? And it's going to get even better over time. Okay, here we go, chapter 11. Let's meet a man, and actually, I think he is still alive, James Kaler. You will find him. You can type his name in. He is all over the internet. And we want to tell you a little bit about, actually, I was reading the book last night. That book really has some cool stories in it. So if you haven't been reading the book, I sent out a link. You have free access to an electronic version for the rest of the semester, or use your own version. But if you don't have a version of the book, you can access this and read the stories. And it really makes it more fun. So it's entertaining. The author is very entertaining. So James Kaler is a scientist, and he had a specialty. And we're going to actually learn about this guy. There he is, Jim. Good old Jim. What did Jim like to study? Jim liked to study a particular pair of binary star systems. He studied binary star system. And a particular kind, I'm going to write over here. I have a new thing that I want to do with you today. I'm going to use, instead of the chalkboard, I have my beautiful whiteboard. Okay, I don't know if it makes a big difference. And actually, that's some glare there. But let's go ahead and write down the guy. The kind of binary that he worked with is called symbiotic binary. Okay, and I do want to make sure you know the names. One of the stars had a large mass, and the other star had a small mass, right? So big M, little m. So we've talked a little bit about this situation before. When the masses are not the same, if you draw a line between their centers, where would you find the center of mass? And it turns out that it's probably going to be, well, probably in this particular situation, the way I've drawn it, it might actually be inside of the larger star. Okay, but today I want to make sure you know the name of this big star that Jim Kaler studied is called a red giant. Okay, make sure you talk about that red giant. And the little tiny star, which by the way was really hot, was called, or is called, a white dwarf. So very small but very hot star. Okay, and so what happens, obviously, they orbit around a common center of mass. And so the big star makes a little orbit, and the little star makes a much bigger orbit. Okay, and so that's just something to keep in mind. But James Kaler studied this. Why did he study this? Well, a symbiotic binary has one of the stars, the big star, feeding the little star. And this is a really cool story. Oh man, it's so cool. Anyways, he studied these particular systems. And one of the systems that he was watching, one day he was watching it and he went to take measurements and it was way too bright. He's like, oh man, something screwed up. And he went and rechecked all of his instrumentation, his cameras, his telescope, hooked it up again. And he still got something incredibly bright. And he realized that he was watching one of these stars explode. And that was a pretty exciting thing. He had actually captured almost the very moment, you know, maybe a day or within a day of the event. So he was really close to watching a star explode. He had been studying this system, and then he actually was there, you know, not almost watching at the moment that one of the stars exploded. And we're going to talk about what that means. A star exploding has a name. Who knows the name? Anybody know the name? Well, you can think about it, but the name that you need to know is called a supernova. All right, but meanwhile, let's talk about that symbiotic binary. One of the things that James Kaler noted is that they would flash periodically, once in a while. And he called that, or we call that, a nova, right? But then what he witnessed was the supernova. So James Kaler, very good, supernova, that's good. Okay, so what is a symbiotic binary system? Now you know the answer. A symbiotic system changes their brightness in regular ways over time. As mass flows from one star, flows onto the other. Okay, so what happens is one star is going to give matter to the other star, and that actually I'll tell you right now, the red giant gives matter. This is the only way it happens, to the white dwarf, and when the matter falls onto the white dwarf surface, which is kind of a weird thing. This is not a star anymore. A white dwarf is a dead star. Then it flashes in a very brief fusion reaction, very quick fusion reaction, and you get a little more light, and we call it a nova, right? So that's a nova. It can happen over and over and over again every time the red giant gives a little bit of mass to the white dwarf, okay? So people used to think that stars live forever, right? That wasn't that long ago. We now are very aware that stars are born, they live, and they die, just like people do. Yeah, okay. Just a lot longer, right? What if you could live as long as a star? Wouldn't that be amazing? Okay. What would you see, right? Maybe one day we will. But anyway, not anytime soon, probably. So this is a question I have not talked about with you. So you have to read all these words. How do astronomers measure stellar evolution? Do they watch a star evolve from its birth to the death? Do they determine the star's stage of evolution in a binary system from a calculation of its orbit? Do they find links between the properties they can measure and the story of stellar evolution? Or do they cannot measure stellar evolution, they guess the age of a star by its color, okay? So why don't you pause the video and think about that for a moment, because I'm about to tell you the answer. First of all, A is wrong. Right? You can't do A because stars live way too long. Even the shortest lifetime of a star is like 100,000 years. Okay? Can they determine the star's stage of evolution in a binary system? Well, not really. They can determine the relative masses, right? Which one has more mass, which one has less mass. That's not right. They can find links between the properties they can measure and the story of stellar evolution. That's incredibly vague. And it happens to be the right answer, right? There are things that we can measure that allow us to infer the age of a star. And that's what we're going to be talking about in this chapter. And then D is just wrong. Of course, we can measure something about stars' ages, okay? And here we go. Lots and lots of stuff. So one of the things we're going to learn today is the concept of luminosity and how it relates to the word magnitude. Oh, good for you. You guys had an idea. No, D, unfortunately, was not right. Okay, so here we go. Measuring lots of stuff. You can pause and look at that list if you want. There's a bunch of words here. And then what we want to do is try to use these measuring tools to calculate the distance to stars, right? That's actually one of our goals, to make a three-dimensional map. Where are the stars? I know we see them around us. But where are they, right? Not just where are they, you know, pointed in some direction in the sky, but how far away from us, right? How far away are they? So we have a number of things to learn in this chapter. Lots and lots of stuff. Okay, so let me get started. Let's go ahead and take a look at some of the things that we want to measure, right? So one measurement, these are properties. Actually, we don't necessarily directly measure them. But anyways, let's talk about that. So luminosity, what does it mean? The luminosity, you need to know this, is the total amount of light energy per second that is emitted by a star or other object, right? Luminosity, the amount of light energy coming out. The distance is the distance, right? So how far away is that object? The temperature of the surface is partly what we're going to use to explain the luminosity. The size, right? A large object has more area, more surface area, and the light comes out of every square meter of the surface. So the more square meters you have, the more light you can have, right? If we'll come back to that. Okay, the mass is going to be pretty critical for determining the life of a star, and composition, what it's made of, and then the velocity. How is it moving? Is it moving towards us or away from us, or maybe not either one? How do we find that? How do we see that? So now, if you look over in the other column, these are the things that we're going to be learning about. There's a word called apparent brightness. It's brightness. Okay, brightness. And from that, we will learn a word called apparent visual magnitude. Okay, and that allows us to compare it to the absolute magnitude to calculate the distance. The concept of parallax, we'll study that today. Parallax is the concept that if you hold your thumb out and look at the background at the same time that you look at your thumb, and then you wink with one eye and then the other, you see that your thumb shifts position from one place to another. But if you bring the thumb really close to your face and do it again, you find out that it shifts quite a bit more. So we can actually see stars shift position because we're riding around on the Earth. And that allows us to measure parallax. Black body spectra is the concept we've talked about in chapter 4, that the light that comes out of a star is dependent on the temperature of the star. So the temperature, the surface temperature of the star, determines what color comes out more than any other, and the amount of light that comes out of it, okay, or part of it at least. Stefan Boltzmann equation, we'll talk about that, okay? In a binary system, you have spectral lines that are going to shift, right? And the reason why is one of the stars will be coming towards us and the other is moving away from us. So you want to remember, right, what's this called? The Doppler effect. What happens when a star comes towards you? The colors or the absorption lines are blue shifted, right? And if the star is moving away from you, the colors are red shifted, okay? So that allows us to see that relative motion and what they're made of. Okay, what they're made of. Okay, so actually, sorry, right here, the relative mass, I'm jumping a little bit. What they're made of is coming from the absorption lines and then Doppler effect, right? So actually, this is inside of here too. They just didn't say that. Okay. All right, so these are the factors. Let's see how we do this, right? So let's start off with the first one. What is luminosity? It is the intrinsic energy output of a star per second. Make sure that you put per second. I don't know why I didn't put that. It is the power, actually, not the energy. But energy per second is the same thing as power. Luminosity can be determined by measuring a star's brightness if we know the distance, okay? So this is the equation. You need to recognize this equation and use it a little tiny bit, not very much. You can ignore the 4 pi, but I think I may have described where that comes from. Maybe I should just review that for a moment. Why not? You know, I'm not in any real hurry, right? We're in a hurry? We're not in a hurry. We're trying to understand. So let me go ahead and make sure you understand. So remember that luminosity is the power that's coming out of a star. And the way that I think about it is every second a star puts out a pulse of energy. It's actually not every second, it's every single moment, right? It's all the time. But I want you to imagine that a star is putting out pulses of energy, and maybe think about it like every second. And so I have a star. Can you guys see the red? I have a star, okay? And in 1 second, it puts out a pulse of energy, right? That 1 second pulse of energy. Well, that pulse of energy is going to move away from the star in every direction at the speed of light. So 1 second later is going to put out another pulse, and the original pulse is now going to be further away from the star, right? This is that pulse has moved away from the star, right, at the speed of light. Okay, I mean, I could put more arrows. More arrows is better, right? Okay, and then 1 second after that, there's another pulse that's being created, and the original pulse is now 2 steps away from the star, right? Every time you're going to take the same distance. So the spacing is supposed to be the same. And what's happening to this thing? By the way, it looks like a circle on my picture, but what's the shape of the surface of energy that's moving away from the star, it's a sphere, right? So this pulse of energy, each pulse has the same amount of energy because it's 1 second of energy, right? Each one has the same energy, but the energy is being spread over a larger and larger sphere. So if you take that energy and you spread it, the surface area of a sphere has a really beautiful formula. And here, if we call this D, the distance D, the surface area is 4 pi D squared. And so that's actually what's going on, right? The star in the middle has a certain luminosity. Remember, luminosity is the power of a star, which means the energy per second. Okay, and that's consistent, usually pretty consistent. And every second it's going to pulse out and provide this energy to the rest of the universe, right? But as the pulse goes further away, it's spread over a larger and larger sphere, which means the intensity of the light is going down as 1 over d squared, right? This is called an inverse square law. All right, so what does that mean? The further away you get from the star, the less intense the light energy will be, okay? And we've studied this already. We already know about this, right? We talked about sunlight. For example, comparing the Earth with Jupiter, right? What was it? When you go to Jupiter, which is 5 AUs from the sun, the sunlight is 1/25th as bright. The intensity is 1/25th as much. So we have this thing, by the way, called the magnitude scale. And the name is apparent, write this down, apparent visual magnitude, because we're talking about visible light. Now, there are actually other magnitude scales. There's actually apparent ultraviolet magnitude, apparent infrared magnitude, apparent X-ray magnitude, apparent gamma ray magnitude, apparent radio magnitude, right? You can actually think about magnitude being any one of these segments of the electromagnetic spectrum. But we're going to just focus on the visible part, right? What we can see with our human eyes. And so let me actually tell you a little story, because that's the fun part of this class, right? So I'm going back here to tell you a fun story. This is the story of a Greek by the name of Hipparchus. Now, Hipparchus was living, you know, I think a couple hundred BC. The dates are not really critical. I think it was like 190 BC. To 120 BC, right? BCE, sorry, we have a new way to talk about it. Again, I'm not a history professor, so I'm weak when it comes to history. But I do want to tell you that Hipparchus came up with this concept that when he looked at the night sky, he could see stars with different brightness. And he made star charts, which, by the way, were then further elaborated on by Ptolemy. Remember Ptolemy? He built us the geocentric model for the universe. But anyways, the original was Hipparchus, and Hipparchus decided, thank you, Hipparchus, I'm going to say that several times today, for creating this very backward system, but it's what we use. He created a system in which he saw, when he looked at the stars, 6 different families of brightness, right? So we're talking about this fellow named Hipparchus. Hipparchus, he was Greek, you know. Not that that even matters, but he's a Greek guy. And one of the things that he saw was 6 levels of brightness for the stars. Okay? But this is the part that was a little backwards in what he decided. He said that the brightest was the first magnitude star. So I'm going to go ahead and turn this into a number line. And I'm going to say that on the scale, this is called the magnitude. And the, again, apparent visual is what we call it today. If you go in a astronomy research paper, they put a little M and they'll put a V. We won't use the V. We'll understand that the V is supposed to be there, but we're just going to use the little M. And he said that the brightest stars were ones. These were according to him, right? This is the brightest. And the dimmest stars were a 6. So this is a very strange thing. Usually when you turn up the volume, the bigger the number, the louder it gets, right? But, you know, thank you, Hipparchus, for creating a backwards system, right? In stars, the larger the number, the dimmer the star, right? Their magnitude number indicates how bright it appears to your human eye, right? We're in the visible part of the spectrum. So thank you, Hipparchus. Now, apparently, he was not as well traveled as we might have hoped, because one of the stars that he left out was the brightest star in the sky. Does anybody know the name of the brightest star in the sky? You can pause for a second. I'm about to tell you. And it turns out it was not in his chart. So what happens if you have a star that's brighter than a 1? Well, brighter than a 1, keep the pattern, would be a 0. And it turns out this star is even brighter than that. Actually, by the way, I'm going to go ahead and tell you the names of a few stars and other objects. And it's just to help you understand, you know, what's typical, what you can kind of see. There is a star that we know in the night sky. It's actually not visible right at this moment, except if you get up early. But a star by the name of Vega is a calibration star, and it has a magnitude of 0. So it's actually one of the stars that you might have heard of that before. It's pretty cool. That will be our North Star one day. You know, that's kind of a neat thing. Somebody's asking, oh, Sirius. Yes, you're right. The brightest star in the sky is Sirius. And where is Sirius? Well, it's brighter than Vega. Where will it be? So if you're brighter than 0, you have no choice. What are you going to be? And the answer is you've got to be negative. Oy. Okay, so, you know, this is what you get, right? When you follow Hipparchus, which is what we do. So we have negative magnitudes, and negative magnitudes are really bright. In fact, you could say, actually, the number is about negative 1.42. We'll just say like negative 1.5. Negative 1.5 on the scale is the star called Sirius. This is the brightest star in the sky. There is no star other than our sun that is brighter. So no star in the night sky is brighter than Sirius. This is the lowest magnitude number that you would see for a star. But if you are taking the lab or you've seen the sky, you know that there are things that are brighter than stars. And what would they be? And the answer is the planets. Okay. So I want to go ahead and say to you right now that Jupiter is approximately -2. That's a pretty bright Jupiter. But in fact, there are things that are brighter than Jupiter. What's brighter than Jupiter? -3, -4. What gets really bright is the planet Venus. Okay, so I've just thrown in a couple of things. Now, the scale has to go down quite a bit because there are some brighter things in the sky. What's brighter than a moon? I just gave it away. What's brighter than a planet? And the answer is the moon. Okay. And so I'm going to break the scale, right? I'm going to break it. And I'm going to put the moon right here. The full moon, you could write this down, is approximately -13. Okay. That's on the slide. So, but I'm not showing you the slide. So, hey, that's kind of cool. And what's brighter than the full moon? And the answer is the sun. You can try to guess if you want. Again, I'm going to break the scale because it's way down here. But the sun, of course, is super bright, and I'm going to go ahead and put it in. And the sun is about, what did I put it there? -27, okay, the sun. And there's not much brighter than that, right? Well, there are some things that if we were close enough to them, we would see them as being brighter than the sun. The sun is not the brightest star, it's not the most luminous star. I want to use the word that you're supposed to know, okay? So this is the negative side of the scale. There's not much more negative than the sun, right? Because that's the brightest object in our neighborhood. But if you go the other direction, you want to understand there are plenty of objects, right? So what about the 6? We actually kept the 6, and we need to know that the 6 is, in fact, the dimmest star that can be seen on a good night by a naked eye, right? That means without any help, naked eye, but of course a clear sky, right? Good conditions, no moisture, you know, very, very dry air, not wavy air, right? No wind and stuff like that. So in those conditions, a 6 magnitude star, no light pollution, right? Again, then you can see a 6. Now, are there stars that are dimmer than a 6? Well, of course. And what would be an example? Well, how about a 7, right? A 7 is going to be so dim that you can't actually see it with your eye, right? It'll be just too dim for you. Now, with light pollution, what happens is you can't even see the 6s, right? So unfortunately, with light pollution, you know, you get down to the 5 or 4 or 3 or even 2. I'm not kidding, right? New York City, this was pretty much what you could see. I could see Orion, you know, and then anything else would be like faded. All right, not relevant. Okay, well, what about, how do we enhance our vision? Well, you might use binoculars or a small telescope. Let's talk about a small telescope. A small telescope will get you all the way to like a 12, okay? So a small telescope. We'll get you to a 12. With a bigger telescope, you know, you could go a little bit bigger. You know, again, something that you and I could possibly own, we might be able to get to like a 14, you know, larger. Now, what about the really big telescope? So think about it for a second. What is the best telescope that you have ever heard about? The best one in the entire human existence. And I'm pretty much, you're gonna probably think of the same thing that I think about, and that would be the Hubble. Right, that's pretty much right now the best thing. Now, it's not always going to be. It turns out technology is improving, but the Hubble with the cameras and the ability to point at one section of the sky consistently can get to about positive 30. Now, these numbers are not exact. I mean, in fact, some of them may even have changed. It might be 31 now or 32, but it gives you the right idea. There's a huge range of magnitudes that you want to be aware of, right? And this is the part of astronomy. So now it turns out that we, as we adopted the scale, we needed to, you know, needed to make it more mathematical and use it precisely. And so we will actually. So you know, you can see these numbers; they're pretty close to. He says Hubble is 32, but I'm not sure about that. Sometimes he says things that I don't agree with. But anyways, let's say 32. Fine. Okay. So, yeah, what are we trying to say about that? Oh, yeah, we need some numbers. We need to know what this really means. So, yeah, actually, I just jumped ahead. I shouldn't have jumped ahead. I should have just kept writing because I have more to write. All right, so now this is the part where I tell you what you need to know, right? This is what you need to know. What exactly is happening with this magnitude scale? How is a magnitude 3 different from a magnitude 4? Which one is brighter? Okay, obviously the lower number is brighter, but how much brighter? And so this is the part that I'm gonna tell you. It's a little bit weird, right? And again, thank you, Hipparchus. Because of you, we decided to create the scale in this way with a lower number magnitude, and in fact, negatives being really bright, right? The lower the number on the scale, the brighter it is, the higher the number, the dimmer it is. And thanks to you, we have a very weird non-linear scale. The scale is not obvious and intuitive. And so I need to teach you just a little tiny bit about how this works. So what I'm going to ask you to do is maybe write down a few sentences. I'm going to ask you to memorize the difference in brightness that happens because of a difference in magnitude, right? So here's the question. How much brighter is a magnitude 3 than a magnitude 4? And this is a question that you will have on your next exam. How much brighter is a magnitude 3 star than a magnitude 4 star? And you don't know the answer yet, but I'm about to tell you, right? You can write this down. M equal 3 is, and there's a number here, right? It's a multiplication factor. It is 2.5. Now, the real number is 2.512. You don't need it. But it's 2.5 times as bright as magnitude 4. So it doesn't matter what magnitude number you start at. If you go up by one number, that star is going to be, well, sorry, if you go down by one number from 4 to 3, then the 3 is 2.5 times as bright. But it actually doesn't matter what number you start at. So suppose you start at 10, right? What's 2.5 times as bright as a magnitude 10 star? A magnitude 9. Or you start at 3. I just did 3. Yeah, you start at 3. You drop down to 2, right? In fact, let's do that. How about a magnitude 2, right? How much brighter is a magnitude 2 as bright as magnitude 4. We know 2 is brighter than 4, but how much brighter is a magnitude 2 than a magnitude 4. Now, if I give you, just pause the video for a second, think about it, and come up with an answer and guess, okay? And half of the class usually guesses 5, which is incorrect. So why is that incorrect? Well, 2.5 plus 2.5 is 5, but if you notice, there's some multiplication. And so the answer is, when you take two steps in the magnitude scale, when you go two steps below, right, a 4, take two steps down, then you have to take this factor, 2.5, and you have to multiply it times 2.5 again, 2.5 squared, right? However many steps you've dropped, this is how you figure out the difference in the brightness. And 2.5 times 2.5, I'm pretty good at mental math. The answer is 6.25 times as bright. You want to memorize that. So one step, one magnitude number difference is 2.5. Two magnitude numbers different is 6 times as bright, 6.25 times as bright. And the last one you need to memorize is the one that kind of started it all. Actually, this is where we get the number 2.5. And so you'd be like, why are you making me memorize this? Because it happens to be easy. A magnitude 1 is blank times as bright as a magnitude 6, right? So how many steps have I taken? To drop down from 6 to 1 is 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. That's 5 steps, right? So the answer is 2.5 to the fifth power. Now, everybody knows how to do that in your head. 2.5 times 2.5 times 2.5 times 2.5 times 2.5. But this is the part that's kind of cool. It happens to be exactly 100. So a star, when you drop by 5 magnitude numbers, that star is 100 times as bright as the higher numbered star. And so these are the 3 things that you want to memorize. One magnitude number difference, 2, and 5, right? And this is actually where it comes from. So if you take the number 2.512 and raise it to the fifth power, you get 100. So how would this work, right? If you were in a more mathematical class, I could say to you, hey, I have 2 identical stars, right? And one of the stars is, 5 light years from the Earth. You want to see how this works? I'm going to just show you. You don't need to do this, but just to show you how this works. 2 identical stars. What is the magnitude of, so I tell you the magnitude of the first star. And then you say, well, if it's how far away, then what happens? Okay, so let me just show you how that would work. So I have 2 identical stars somehow, and there are lots of stars that are pretty close to each other. We can say that there's 2 identical stars. So I have one star that I know. So here I am. Here we're on Earth, right? And we see one star. Here's our star. And this one, we see this star has a magnitude of 5, okay? But I happen to know the distance is, 5 light years away, okay? What happens if I go a distance of, I'm trying to make this hard. Okay, I gotta go much further. Let's go much further, right? So just pretend, I know I can't draw it very well. Now 50 light years, right? So what did I just do to the distance? The same star, somehow the same luminosity, right? Same luminosity. What happens to the magnitude? How bright will it be? If you remember, we have this brightness formula, which is L divided by 4 pi d squared, right? So what happens when you go from 5 to 50 is you went 10 times as far. So what happens to the brightness when you go 10 times as far, right? If you put in this formula, so for star number 1, and the question is, what about star number 2, right? So star number 1, how about star number 2? It's going to be 4 pi times 10 times the distance. I'm not actually putting any numbers in, but I want to notice this. What happens because of that factor of 10 right here? It's 10 squared. What will it be? It's going to be 1 over 100. Times L over 4 pi d squared. Okay. Well, this was the original brightness. So what do you see? This star is going to appear 1/100th as bright. So what should happen to the magnitude number? Should I go up or down? Da, 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 da. It's dimmer. You got to go up. How many steps? Well, remember what 100 is? A difference of brightness by of 100 is exactly 5 steps. So what's the magnitude? 5 plus 5, it is 10. Ta-da! That's how you do this mathematically. Okay, now we don't actually do this kind of math in the class, but I would like you to understand, if I know how bright it should be, which we'll talk about in just a second, and I see how bright it is, I can actually figure out the distance because of that, right? So if I knew these two stars are the same, and I see this one being dimmer, I can actually calculate how far away it is as a result of that. Okay, so finally then, let me go ahead and do one last little detail. Because the question is, why are some stars bright and some stars dim? And the answer to the question is, well, there's more than one right answer. Why are some stars bright and some stars dim? If you look at the formula, it has two factors, right? The two factors for brightness are what? The L and the D, right? So why are some stars, why are stars bright? Why are stars bright? That's my question. Okay, here's the brightness formula, L over 4 pi D squared. How do you get a big number for B? And the answer is there's more than one right answer. Right? There's more than one right answer. Everybody hear me okay? Okay. The more the right answer, how do you get a bright star? So L could be big. That's one of the ways, right? You have a big number on the top. Or there's another way, right? What's the other way? You're dividing by D. What makes the answer become large? D is small. So when we look up at the sky, we see all these bright stars. There's not a whole lot of bright stars. In fact, you know, I could probably list the top 20 bright stars. And of those bright stars, how many of them have great, you know, big luminosities, and how many of them are just close? And it turns out about half and half. So you want to know that it's very difficult to just say, hey, that star is closer to us, or that star is more luminous. You do not know, right? So this is pretty frustrating. You know, as a scientist, I don't like that. I don't like not knowing, right? I want to say, well, actually, there's a way for me to determine that. And in fact, there is, okay? But the way we do this is we bring up a new idea. What if all of the stars were the same distance from us, right? What if that was true? Then why would some stars be bright and the other stars be dim? Well, this is no longer a factor, right? The distance is not going to change. So the only thing that would happen is you would change your luminosity. And the stars that were more luminous would have higher brightness. The stars that were less luminous would have lower brightness, right? It would somehow cut out the whole problem of the distance. And in fact, we did that, right? So mathematically, we are going to move the stars to the same distance away from the Earth. Mathematically, and we're going to give it a new name, right? We're not going to have the problem of more than one reason for the stars being bright. We have only one reason, that is the luminosity. And the term is called the absolute magnitude. Okay, magnitude. Okay, now we're gonna use a different letter. We're gonna use a big M for absolute magnitude. Absolute magnitude is not different distances. We move mathematically the stars to the same distance. And the distance is 10 parsecs. Okay, remember we abbreviate that, equals 10 PC. If anybody remembers, the PC is 3.26 light years. So what's 10 parsecs? It's 32.6 light years, okay? That's the definition. So if you move all the stars to the same distance and then ask what is their apparent magnitude, then you have what is called the absolute magnitude. So one more time, what's the definition? The apparent magnitude when a star is moved, it's not really moved, but mathematically moved, to a distance of 10 parsecs. Okay, so it's a mathematical operation. Now, what if a star is already at 10 parsecs? Maybe that's how far away it is from the Earth. Then what's going to happen with the absolute magnitude and the apparent magnitude? Well, when you go to move it, you don't do anything, right? It stays the same. So what would it mean? The apparent magnitude and the absolute magnitude are the same number. So are there any stars like that? What do you think? And the answer is, of course there are. There's going to be stars that are about 33 light years from the Earth. And if you look at them, their apparent magnitude is the same as their absolute magnitude. But most of the stars in the universe are not that distance, right? Some are closer, some are further. What will happen to the apparent magnitude if you move something, right? Well, the question is, which way did you move it, right? Suppose a star begins not at 10 parsecs, maybe at 1 parsec or 2 parsec, right? Then what happens? When you move it to 10, is it going to get brighter or dimmer? And the answer is dimmer, right? It's going to move further away. So that one, you would expect the absolute magnitude number, right, number to be higher on the magnitude scale. It would be a higher number because it's a dimmer looking star. On the other hand, what if a star begins 1,000 light years or, you know, 300 parsecs from the Earth, something like that? When you move it to 10 parsecs, it's going to be incredibly close compared to where it was before, which means you're going to see it as brighter. That means that the absolute magnitude is going to be a much lower number on the magnitude scale because it is so much brighter. Okay? So does everybody understand? You can absolutely compare the apparent and the absolute magnitude. And by comparing them, guess what? You can calculate this is actually a pretty fundamental idea in astronomy called the standard candle method. If I know the absolute magnitude, how bright a star should appear from 10 parsecs, and I compare it to how bright the star is from my own eye, from Earth, the apparent magnitude, then I can calculate the distance to the star, known as the standard candle method. Okay? Pretty big deal in astronomy. It's how we learned everything up until a few years ago. Now we have one more tool, but the standard candle method. Okay, so let's go ahead and go back to our slides. I think stories are more fun. I like telling stories. Thank you guys for listening. Okay, so here is some numbers and a slide. You can follow along at home, right? And if you take a look, so the apparent magnitude, how bright a star appears from Earth, the absolute magnitude, how bright a star would appear if it were seen from 10 parsecs away, if you could mathematically move it. And if you take a look at the numbers, ignore the distance column for a second. You're going to need to figure this out yourself. Take a look at Sirius, look at the apparent magnitude, look at the absolute magnitude. What do you notice? Did the number get bigger, go higher on the scale, a larger number, you know, higher on the scale? Or lower? And the answer is it went up, right? It went up. So what does that mean? It got dimmer. So when we went to the absolute magnitude and moved it to a distance of 10 parsecs, it got dimmer, which means we moved it further away from the Earth. So you can deduce that Sirius must be closer than 10 parsecs from the Earth. Take a look at the distance column. 2.6, of course. Yeah. See, it starts 2.6 when we're measuring the apparent magnitude. When we move it to 10 parsecs, it appears dimmer. Are there any that get brighter, though? Let's take a look. Any numbers that are getting lower on the scale? And not the first three, but the fourth one, Arcturus. Take a look. The number apparent magnitude is -0.05. But look at the absolute magnitude, -0.31. It got brighter, which means what? That when we moved it to 10 parsecs, it got closer to us and therefore appeared brighter. And in fact, look at the distance, 11.1 parsecs. So yes, it's just a little bit further than 10 parsecs. Take a look at some of the ones that are more dramatic. How about this one, Canopus, which we cannot see. It's only visible in the southern hemisphere. -0.62. And then when you do absolute magnitude, -5.53. That's a huge jump. And so this is a really luminous star, right? Take a look at the distance. It is 100 parsecs away. So when you move it to 10, you're moving much, much closer. Therefore, it appears much brighter. Okay, so those are some of the things to think about. But again, it's called the standard candle method. Okay, distance is a property. Okay, yeah. Okay, so Skip that. Okay. So here we go. Parallax, concept of parallax. How does it work? I mentioned to you that you put your thumb out. I just like the thumb. It's good enough. I mean, you could do this if you want. And if you wink with one eye, then the other, we see it shifting. So parallax is the change in position of a star or object because of the motion of the of changing your observation point. So when we're looking at stars, sorry, it's going to be the motion of the Earth around the sun that's causing this. Okay. So one of the things to notice is that we can observe parallax with just having two eyes. The positions of our eyes are slightly different. So the distance between the observation points is known as the baseline. And so we have a fixed baseline because our eyes don't change position. If you could somehow, yeah, that's silly. If you could move your eyes further apart, your baseline would grow, it would be larger. And that's actually interesting because the larger, this is a little note for you, the larger your baseline, the better the precision on your parallax will be, which means the more decimal places you will be able to measure. Okay. So you might remember a long time ago, this guy named Aristotle said that he could not observe any stars changing position. So he concluded that the Earth is not moving. And it's obviously he's wrong, but he wasn't wrong for his time, right? There was no way for him to observe that movement. The parallax angle, the shift in position is too small. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and define the parallax angle for you right now using this picture. You can see that we are on the Earth, we're riding around the sun, and therefore we are riding on a big circle, which is 1 AU in radius. And what we're going to do is we're going to watch the star. We're going to take a picture of the star, and then we're going to take a picture again when we're as far away from our original position as possible. And this gives us the best ability to see a shift in position. So what is the baseline? This is one of the questions that I'm going to be asking you on the next test. What is the baseline for our observations on Earth? And the answer is 1, 2 AU, right? That's the answer. What if we could move further away from the sun and do this again, right? Let's say we could go to Mars, which is about 1.5. Would we have a larger baseline? And the answer is, of course we would. In fact, it would become 3 AU, which is going to be better. What if we go to Jupiter, which is 5 AUs from the sun? Then our baseline becomes 10 AU. Bang, why don't we just do this? Well, there's the issue of taking the pictures, right? When we do a parallax measurement, we have to wait 6 months before we can do that measurement again, right? We have to wait 6 months to be able to compare the two photos to each other. What about on Mars, which takes nearly 2 years to go around? What happens? You got to wait a year between your measurements. What about Jupiter that takes 12 years to go once around the sun? You need to wait about 6 years between the measurements. So yes, you can improve your baseline. But the cost is you have to wait longer between your pictures to be able to measure that parallax difference. But I predict that we will be doing this. And unfortunately, one of the problems with astronomy is we have been stuck on Earth for a very long time. And our measurements are from Earth. And therefore, all of our tables, our data tables for measuring the distance to the stars, are based on our observations from Earth. But every few years, we have an improvement in technology that allows us to more precisely measure the parallax. And what happens is we update those distances. Now they become, when we change those distances, everything else that we've done since then is affected. So every few years, all of the tables for astronomical data are getting updated. So I predict, because I know it's going to happen, that this is going to happen again, right? And we will have, you know, perhaps a satellite watching from the orbit of Jupiter, or maybe eventually from Saturn, or maybe even further. And what will happen is the data will get more and more precise. So as astronomy progresses and technological innovation, we constantly are updating the numbers in our charts. So you kind of have to be aware when you see uncertainty, it's not that we want it to be there. It's just a fact of life that we are limited in where we are watching the stars. Okay. Okay. So there is a formula. You don't have to use it, but it's kind of a cool, simple formula. If you measure This parallax angle is measured in a very particular way, which I'll talk about. It turns out to be, by the way, just make sure you understand, the parallax angle is not the full angle difference for the star. It's just measured as half of that. So that's the definition of parallax angle. But the question is, what is that? What is going on? So the angles that we're going to be measuring in parallax, if we were doing a more mathematical class, are really small. And so actually one of the ideas is that you have to be aware, they're not degrees, right? A degree is an incredibly large angle. The angles that we're going to be dealing with are incredibly small. In fact, they are going to be not degrees, but fractions of a degree. And so you want to know, how do we measure really tiny angles? What is the unit that we use? Okay, so what is the unit? And the unit is, the preferred unit is the, sorry, the preferred unit is the, let me get to this. So 1 degree is too big. 1 degree is way too big. So what we're going to do is we're going to learn how to divide it into smaller pieces. How many, what's a smaller piece? It turns out we've invented something called arc minutes and arc seconds. So it turns out there are 60 arc minutes in 1 degree. Okay, so 1 degree, this is the symbol version of it, equals 60, and a single flash means an arc minute. But that's too big. An arc minute is too big for measuring parallax angle. So we actually want to divide an arc minute. 1 arc minute is equal to 60 arc seconds. Okay, so same idea. 1 arc minute is 60 arc seconds. So this is finally the level where we're measuring the parallax angle. It's going to be arc seconds. So I want you to think about that, for example. What exactly is parallax angle? So one more time, you have the Earth going around the Sun. And you could have a star out here. Sorry, I don't want to do that. Let's put a line out here. So we're measuring the position of a star. Here's the star. And we're seeing how it shifts in position, right? And this is called the parallax angle. And so I'm going to write down something kind of important. If the parallax angle of 1 arc second, right? If the parallax angle is 1 arc second, then the distance is equal to 1 parsec. Okay, so the definition of a parsec is coming exactly from parallax angles. So a parallax angle of 1 arc second is called a parsec. What's the distance? 3.26 light years, right? That's what it is. So if a star was 3.26 light years from us, we would measure this angle to be 1 arc second. So here's the question, right? If the star was exactly 1 parsec, it would be 1 arc second, which is 3.26 light years. But you may know that the nearest star is more than that. The nearest star is a distance of 4.2 light years, right? A little bit more. Actually, almost a whole nother light year. So what does that mean? What happens to the size of your parallax angle if you move the star further away? Does it get bigger or smaller? You can kind of visualize that, right? If I draw the parallax angle now, what does it look like? Is it getting bigger or smaller? And the answer is, it's getting smaller. So the nearest star has a parallax angle which is less than 1 arc second. That's the closest star, which means that is the largest parallax angle that you can even have, right? Because stars are very far away, which means that they're going to be even further, right? A star that is 100 light years away, or 100 parsecs away, is going to have an even tinier parallax angle. So just so you know, how good is this technique? How far away can you measure? So we got the Earth and our Sun, our solar system, right? How far away can we measure? And the answer is about 1,000 parsecs. That's it, right? That's as far away. So we are going to be able to see any of the stars that are about 3,260 light years from the Earth. And that's it. So is that pretty much the entire Milky Way, right? And the answer is not even close. The Milky Way is 100,000 light years across, or 30,000 parsecs across, and we can do only 1,000. So this technique, while valuable and good, only gives us the distances to the nearest stars. Okay, so parallax is really cool, but all it's good for is the closest stars to us, within 1,000 parsecs of the Earth. All right, well, so let's learn if there are some other techniques. And of course, there are some other techniques. So the standard candle idea, very simple idea, very powerful idea. It says that if you know the absolute magnitude of a star, how bright it would appear, how the magnitude as it would appear from 10 parsecs, and then you measure directly its apparent magnitude by comparing those two numbers, you can calculate the distance to that star. So it turns out that this was actually studied, you know, quite a lot, looking for ways to know what the absolute magnitude of a star is. And I'm very excited to share with you one of the first amazing methods, which, by the way, is going to unlock incredibly important information after our next exam. How did we discover how big the universe is? This was the beginning of that step. And we're going to talk about a concept called a Cepheid variable. A Cepheid variable star. So Henrietta Swan Leavitt, you want to write her name down because she is a hero in astronomy. A heroine, a hero. She's a hero. Anyways, I don't know. Heroine, hero. She's a super character, a great character to talk about. She discovered something important, that these stars called Cepheid variables in the constellation Cepheus the King would pulsate in brightness. Okay, I'm not going to describe how that happens. Actually, it's pretty cool. What happens is the outer layer changes its transparency and becomes more or less transparent or more or less opaque. And as a result, the brightness changes in a regular way. You don't have to know that. That's just more than you need to know. But what you do need to know is she discovered an important relationship between the luminosity and the mass of the star. Luminosity and the mass of the star. Oh, luminosity and period, sorry, period. The mass will come later, sorry about that. Okay, so actually I forgot something important, but you can probably just think about this. Absolute magnitude is the concept that all the stars are the same distance from us, 10 parsecs. So why are some stars brighter than others? The answer was their luminosity. So absolute magnitude and luminosity are kind of interchangeable. There's a way for me to calculate directly from the luminosity what its absolute magnitude is because I know the distance. It's 10 parsecs. Okay. So just keep that in mind. In astronomy, if we use absolute magnitude as one of our axes, you could change that to luminosity and it would work, right? There's going to be a relationship. There's a direct correspondence between absolute magnitude and luminosity, okay? So what was the relationship that Henrietta Swan Leavitt discovered? And this is one that you're going to be tested on in your next exam. And this is it. The Cepheid variable has a regular period. Now, the period, this is not linear. It doesn't matter. Don't worry about it. What you need to see is that straight line relationship. There's a way for us to measure how a star is changing. So what is it doing? It's pulsating, getting brighter and getting dimmer, and getting brighter and getting dimmer. And you can measure the time between those peaks of brightness. That's called the period. So you go to the period here, right? And you say, oh, it's a 5-day period or a 10-day period. Let's say it's a 10-day period. I would be able to go up to the graph, and from that, I could figure out what the luminosity of that star has to be. So we'll learn later how she managed to, I mean, she didn't know why. She just observed that this relationship worked. But again, if you know the luminosity, you know the absolute magnitude. So if you look at that star and you know its absolute magnitude, and then you measure that star's apparent magnitude, what can you figure out? And if you were here, you would tell me, I know the distance. Okay, so this was one of the first techniques that allowed us to measure much, much greater distances. This one will actually work to millions of light years. Whoa, this is such an improvement, and you'll learn why this is so critical. But I think I'm just about ready to stop. But anyways, we just discovered that this is a second technique for measuring distance. The way it works is called the standard candle method. You measure the pulsation period of the Cepheid variable star, and you can look up the luminosity, which allows you to calculate the absolute magnitude. So in other words, by knowing the pulsation period, you know the absolute magnitude. When you compare it to the apparent magnitude, you can calculate the distance. All right. So I am finishing my stream, and thank you guys for joining me on the live stream. If you're watching the recording or the live stream, I am going to now write questions based on the material that we covered. And that will be, if you take that little quiz, that will be how you get your participation points. So please be sure to do that. I will leave it open for a little while. I hope you have a wonderful break. And find a way to relax and be with people that you care about. Just talk to them. And yeah, I'm not going to go to Hawaii, kind of bummed. But the governor said, don't come. And I'm like, I guess I can't come. But I'm going to go ahead and vacation in Santa Barbara and make the most of it and be with people I love. Okay, so you guys find people to talk to. Don't be alone. You have to be alone physically maybe, but you can always Skype. You can Zoom meeting, whatever, find a way to communicate with people. Don't be alone necessarily, okay? All right, have a wonderful break. Bye.